I know. 3 months and nothing from me for the masses. However, aside from my smiling face, I'm sure you remember this gentleman. For those uninitiated, though, if you could reintroduce yourself.
My name is Thomas Sitch. I'm the head of Clockwork Throne Studios, and we have been diligently working on a massively multiplayer game about vampires called Shadow's Kiss, which has been in the works the last 2 years and is now on a Kickstarter.
Yeah, as I recall, I interviewed you last year about this around the time of the Vampire Ball.
Vampire Ball it was, yeah.
Yeah, got a lot of hits, which was great. So thank you on that, and thank you for the opportunity. I just caught a little bit of a documentary going on with your group doing research on what's going on. I gotta give my condolences. Those poor guys, they didn't deserve to go out like that.
We did have to hire some new designers, and Trey only works nights now. But sometimes there has to be some pain for your art. There has to be some sacrifice. You know, Odo Lilienthal famously said sacrifices must be made, and we wanted to be authentic in how vampires fight and how vampires feed. So some research was necessary.
I mean, if you're gonna go method, you might as well, right?
Yes.
But also, for those who were following, you know, congrats on actually getting, you know, level one pretty much set up. And for those who don't know, in under 36 hours after you launching your Kickstarter, you pretty much got it taken care of.
Yeah, we covered the core funding goal. And the core funding goal is that's our skeleton crew and make it the first 30 playable levels. So we're definitely trying to get it beyond that. For our first couple stretch goals included crafting and ceremonial magic, which is very cool. We want to work up to be able to get to adepts, which are witches or ceremonial magicians, to get to the revenants, which are resurrected slayers, and of course our loop guru, which are werewolves. So we're pushing for these stretch goals to be able to afford more. But yes, being able to knock out the Kickstarter, the basic core funding in the first 36 hours was great, and that kind of momentum has just been a wonder for us. We're truly, you know, grateful for it.
Yeah, if that didn't relight any fires that might have dimmed for a little while, I mean, that's got to be some reassurance that you have an audience. They want this, they want it tout suite.
That's market validation. I know a lot of people felt burned when World of Darkness Online was canceled. You know, there's been nothing else that has come up along those lines, and that's in our challenge. It's like, if you want to play a game that has you as a mech pilot, if you want to play an MMO that has you as a star commander or as a wizard, those games are out there. If you want to play a game that lets you be a vampire or a werewolf or a witch of some sort, nobody's doing that.
I mean, you got DC Universe Online, Champions Online,
like Batman.
But even then, I mean, you either have original characters that are still based around an archetype, or you have an actual branding that you're just aping off of.
Yeah, absolutely.
This is that you're not connected to World of Darkness or Vampire the Masquerade or any of that.
No, and actually we should take some time to say that, like, check out our mythology, because we actually have a very cool original content. Our vampires derive from the Dark Goddess. There is this you know, we don't have vampire ethnic groups. You promote into these different vampire types, be it the zombie lord or the tenebrous vampire or the high vampires or the succubae or the incubae and so forth. So it is definitely, we have our own thing and we're very proud of it. But there's certain archetypal stuff from people who've watched Buffy or Angel or The Lost Boys or read the works of Anne Rice that, you know, we want to tap into. We want you to be able to cast yourself as one of those characters and live that fantasy in an online world with your friends.
That's awesome. Now, I mean, there's probably going to be that smart aleck troll out there. It's like, oh, so we all dress in black, right? I mean, clearly the aesthetic is going to be a lot more vibrant and showcase a lot of the goth community as well, right?
Yeah. It's the sexy vampires always have to draw back to our goth and vampire roots. And I got into, I'll date myself, I got into the goth vampire scene in the 90s in Los Angeles and Fan Club. And yeah, black was popular and it was no longer cool to dress up as a crow, but we incorporate that. We also, you know, have some of the other archetypes, the more rugged, wild, torn jeans vampire, the more high society type, and so forth. So, you know, the good thing about it, well, I think a good MMO lets you play the character you want to be, but we are definitely working from a place of gothic horror.
But, I mean, once again, there's really nothing off the top of my head. I can't think of anything. I mean, if you dive into, like, the Steamverse, you might find something that has like 12 people playing it, but like I said,
making MMOs isn't easy. I mean, we may be a small upstart group, but I've been making MMOs literally for 17 years. My first project was Shadowbane right here in Austin, Texas in 2003.
Which, once again, congrats for being an Austin group that's actually succeeding at this.
Yes, yes, you gotta keep the city alive on that. But yeah, making an MMO is hard. You have to bring all these things together. And at the time that we are going to this Kickstarter, as of this time, November 2017, we have that core architecture in place. We have that stuff that most people fall on their faces on is up and working. So, you know, what we've asked for is the money to make the levels, to make the adversaries, to make the quests, and the character customization and so forth. So that's, we're actually in the easy stuff now. We just need to get those last 9 hours.
Okay, now, along the line, you know, to segue back to you being Austin-based, is the city and or world like a dark, perverted version of Austin, or
is it? It draws from it, but okay. It's actually, the name of the city is San Cipriano, and that is a play on the name of the Catholic saint of occultists, San Ciprio. So San Cipriano is actually a strange merging of Austin, of San Francisco, and of Seattle. And it is set in a coastal city, so it's not technically Austin as it would be. Obviously, the San Cipriano shots you see in our mockumentary are all filmed here in Austin.
Wait, mockumentary?
I mean our entirely factual documentary, so yes.
Oh, okay. Next you're going to tell me Santa Claus isn't real.
Yeah, that'd be for episode 3.
Oh, okay. But now, a lot of MMOs, one thing that keeps them going for a while is, you know, holiday or season-based stuff. Are you gonna have something outside of a Halloween event? Like, do you have something planned for New Year's or maybe Valentine's Day or St. Patrick's even?
Well, I think obviously for this year we've got the servers running right now, but it's definitely and it's not advanced enough to do seasonal things for next year.
Well, yeah, I mean, I wasn't expecting, like, a big patch to drop in 2 months. You just got everything going.
Well, for next year, I think we'll absolutely... Halloween goes without saying, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I think a solid portion of our fan base, myself included, belong to the Let's Have Halloween All Year Round crowd. And, you know, if you're like me, you throw a Halloween in July party because you need to make it that far, Halloween in June. We'll definitely do seasonal things. We'll probably... I think St. George's Eve, which is in Dracula, where the blue fires mark the locations of hidden treasures.
Okay.
It's a great one. That's actually also falls in Cinco de Mayo, so rather than, you know, appropriating Pueblo holiday, we'll probably search for the blue fires.
Okay, there you go.
Do some other cool things. I think some tongue-in-cheek stuff on Easter and some other things will
probably... Oh, please. You mentioned zombie lords earlier. Please tell me they get a buff on Easter.
Yeah, and zombie rabbits. Well, I'm not going to commit to that, but a good game doesn't take itself too seriously. You know, we have to have a little bit of fun with ourselves sometimes.
Yeah. Now, if I recall, you've mentioned there's voice acting in the game, or you were hoping for voice acting?
We are, so voice acting is challenging. Because we're procedurally generated, we can't have every quest be voice acted the way Star Wars The Old Republic is. It also is spectacularly expensive. You have to do a lot of voice acting.
I can imagine.
But we have the main quest line revolves around King Logan and Queen Daly, and the intro tutorial that leads into that, and we wanted to give that a little panache on it. So we actually have some voice actors that contributed on the mockumentary, and assuming we're able to make this current stretch goal, we're actually going to have them as the voice of the Game Master and a few others for the primary storyline, or at least part of it. Depending on how our funding goes as we go on, we would like to use them more, at least in the main core storyline, so as to kind of take it up a notch.
Okay. Now, I know that you're trying to keep it a lot within the occult world and the supernatural and things like that, but are there any, dare I say, original concepts that are making their way in, instead of like just a gremlin that happens to be a biker, like a new type of creature? Or,
well, one of my favorites is the necromancers, and when you think of necromancers, you think of guys in robes, but these guys are actually mad scientists. It's alive sort of mad scientists, and the dirty secret is they actually used to be vampire slayers. They were a break-off technological sect of slayers that got a hold of Nikola Tesla's technology right after he had died, and that the burning of his laboratory in New York was actually them seizing this technology that could communicate to the dead. But Tesla had discovered it was worse than that. It could also compel the dead. And so the necromancers were corrupted by this power, and they've used it to raise zombies and to command spirits to do things. So they're very starch, lab coat sort of evil scientists that are trying to break down the veil between the living and the dead. And in fact, if we get to do the Revenants are slayers that have been brought back to life after being killed by vampires by the necromancers in order to fight. And some of these Revenants, these resurrected vampire slayers have gotten free will again and have turned on the necromancers who have gone solo. So there's a lot of cool stuff there. And I think that's that draws in a lot of our archetypes, but it's definitely not something we've seen, in a major property or other, movie franchise or anything.
I can already hear the keyboards on Twitter and Tumblr going nuts over this.
Should be pretty awesome.
Just coming up with their own fan fiction off of just what you've said alone. But, do you have a mascot? I mean, would King Logan and Queen Daly be the quote-unquote spokesfolk for this? Or did you have just a general frail figure with dripping teeth?
Well, we have our new cover art has the Vampire Queen with her skull chalice. I'd say Logan and Daly have become kind of an integral part of our culture and our lore, and certainly the core story is told around them. So, I wouldn't call them mascots so much as sort of pivotal guest.
But in the broadest of terms, mascot, clearly not.
Our iconic characters.
Yeah. There we go. I haven't had enough coffee. Can you tell?
It's okay. It's Sunday. I'm with you.
Yeah. 12 a.m. mimosas. Why not? So.
Seems a good idea to me. Why not?
So, I also noticed you got that sick shirt on. Is that going to be something for like the shop, or is that something for the individuals that will be contributing to the stretch goals of the Kickstarter?
So believe it or not, these were for sale in the first year of Shadow's Kiss. We had a store that had them. We've actually discontinued that because it wasn't profitable. It wasn't profitable then. It might be now. Real good fulfillment is difficult because it takes a lot of money out of your Kickstarter to do the shipping and everything on it. I think that makes sense a lot for cartoonists that are already shipping a book, or board games that are already shipping a physical product. We may toss in some t-shirts, but and we may send them out to some of our Patreon fans who are Patreon, not our fans, but our supporters who've been sticking with us. But as a general stretch goal, probably not, just because the cost of shipping it will undo any benefit from people hitting that stretch goal.
That makes sense. But would there be something like that down the line? I mean, Five Nights at Freddy's suddenly became this huge t-shirt factory for some strange reason.
Well, I mean, Five Nights at Freddy's is a good example of a independent game developer making it, right? It's the same with Angry Birds. Once you see merchandise in a row, that means they've got some sweet deals and they are making bank. I mean, merchandise is what made George Lucas rich on Star Wars. So in the immortal words of Mel Brooks in Spaceballs 2, maybe we meet in Spaceballs 2, the quest for more money. Yes, merchandise, and if we get to that point, we'll be sitting pretty and we can definitely work on sequels. So, hopefully.
Like, cut some deal with Todd McFarlane to sculpt your figurines and such.
Yeah, get the whole toy line. We hope to get there, but baby steps, baby steps.
First the webcomic, then the hard copy, then the action figures, and so on, then the movie deal.
Movie deal would be nice.
Yeah. But just for fun, are you by any chance drawing a line in the sand with these other MMOs, like showing that they're not the only game in town, pun firmly intended? like do you secretly just want to take some of Warcraft's fan base?
Well, I think Warcraft raised, the rising tide raises all boats. Warcraft brought so many people into MMOs that as much as we give them grief, they created the modern environment. They also poisoned the water in that all the big guys only want to do imitations of Warcraft, and when they pitch their ideas, they want World of Warcraft numbers, which are in the hundreds of millions of dollars of money being made. So
it's like Warcraft, but with dinosaurs or whatever.
And which is a lot of the stagnation we've seen in MMOs. So we definitely draw a line in the sand saying we're not exactly like that. In fact, we've innovated in a bunch of ways with turn-based combat, with skill system, with classal system, and things like that. So we like to beat up on them a little bit because we want to be different and we want to do some things that are cool and new and are experimental, and we want to have a vampire MMO, which we have not seen. We've been 20 years of vampire tabletop role-playing games. We have no MMO. What the fuck? Here we are. But World of Warcraft also created the MMO world as we know it now, and it made it mainstream. So I can't be too hard on them because we do owe them a lot for that. So a little bit of both.
This is very true. So, are there going to be Twilight jokes in it, in the game?
Yes. There's absolutely Twilight jokes in the game, and there are Twilight jokes in the first episode of the mockumentary. They run into the apparent blood dolls that are looking for sparkling vampires. And our dev team's like, I don't think they sparkle. So, yeah, it's there.
Good. So we clearly have the Twilight mocking. Any nods to Anne Rice's work at all?
We have little homages to Anne Rice, to Lost Boys, to Buffy and Angel. We got a lot of little nudge, wink, winks in there.
So there's like a Lestat Boulevard somewhere.
That would be cool. We should have gotten your input before we started principal shooting. We actually shot the entire mockumentary in 3 days, which is crazy. We did a little follow-up shooting on the Monday afterwards, but it was our group of game developers with an experienced director-writer, and we just went on it. So.
Well, I mean, it works for Robert Rodriguez. Why can't it work for you?
Another great guy. I've had the chance to run into his people here in Austin, and part of the reason the city is the way it is.
Yeah. Hey, I mean, all else fails, that could be some nice cross-promotion if a character of yours showed up on From Dusk Till Dawn.
That bears further research. Rodriguez, if you're watching this, have your people contact my people.
Well, folks, that's the Shadow's Kiss update. Hopefully we'll have a few more coming up. I mean, these guys are busy, so it's not like I can just call them up every weekend. What are you doing now? What are you doing now? But if you liked what's going on, look them up on Facebook, check them out on Twitter. I believe they've got an Instagram as well. And, you know, YouTube, look them up. And above all else, get behind the tank.
Woohoo.